Yeah, let's go train those. We all have lights or anything else. We're all going to pack it in soon.
Well, greetings, everybody. Thank you so much for coming out here. This is sort of a departure for the Institute, not so much in the question being undertaken. We like these big questions like the future of war, and there could hardly be a bigger one. But in that, we're doing a panel. This is our first panel in more than 4 years of operation. So the format is a little, for us at least, experimental. However, I think that will be whatever awkwardness there may be in how I manage this. It'll be much made up for by the excellence of the three experts that we have on hand. So this panel consists of four faculty members at the Air Force Command and Staff College in Montgomery, Alabama. And what they usually do is teach officers from the U.S. military, and I gather that's more than just the Air Force.
It is.
More than just the Air Force. And 70 partner nations, I'm glad we still have partner nations out there, how to examine war at the strategic and operational levels, with an emphasis on strategy, leadership, and international relations. Let me introduce you to them, and I hope they are seated in a way that corresponds to so here we go with the difficulties for me in the format. Are you Professor Dolman?
Nope.
No.
Right next to you.
All right. Then not going from my right to left, we will start with Professor Everett C. Dolman, who is Professor of Comparative Military Studies. He has four books, dozens of articles, and his works include Astropolitik, I kind of like that, Classical Geopolitics in the Space Age, Pure Strategy, Power and Principle in the Space and Information Age, The Warrior State, How Military Organization Structures Politics, and Can Science End War? And tonight he will discuss the future of strategy and the role of space in 21st century conflicts. Then you must be Michael Pavlik. All right, Michael Pavlik here at the end is an associate professor, again, of comparative military strategy. His three books are The Jet Race and the Second World War, The Luftwaffe from 1933 to 1945, and The Military-Industrial Complex in American Society. He has three forthcoming books, including an examination of the air war over Gallipoli during World War I. World War II. I don't suppose that's what you meant.
I blame you. Sure, I typed it. It's your fault.
A Survey of War Since 1945 and A Survey of American Military History, co-written by his fellow panelists. And finally, Dr. Paul Springer, who is no stranger to these parts. This is your
fourth
trip here?
Fourth trip.
All right.
Third,
well,
fourth,
I'll settle
seventh.
On. I'll settle on
undergraduate football games now.
We'll say four. Fourth trip here to Texas Tech, so a real lover of our institution. And he will discuss the rise of hybrid warfare and asymmetrical threats as the primary form of world conflict. He is professor of comparative military studies, chair of the Department of Research. His five publications, that sounds like a big portfolio. At all.
I just kind
Department
of
research.
Just sit there and
okay.
Let the minions do the work.
His five public books are America's Captives, The Treatment of POWs from the Revolutionary War to the War on Terror, Military Robots and Drones, Transforming Civil War Prisons, Lincoln, Liba, and the Laws of War. Was he the guy who was hung after Andersonville?
No.
No. Just another German. No,
that's worse.
That's worse. And 9/11 and the War on Terror, a documentary history. His forthcoming works include the Encyclopedia of Cyber Warfare, Outsourcing Wars to Machines, The Military Robotics Revolution, and Brothers in Peace and War, Robert E. Lee, Joseph E. Johnson, and the West Point Class of 1829. And tonight he will discuss the role of the cyber domain in military robotics in the future of war. So I look to you for guidance. Is there some logical way in which to start this? Shall I start in the order of introduction?
Just point at Dolman and step out of the way.
That is what I will do. We'll have about 10 or 15 minutes of presentation, and then we'll open up for discussion, first briefly among the panelists, and then all you guys. So, it's going to be fun.
Well, good evening. I'll start with some problems of strategy as we're opening it up from a book I wrote a few years ago. Strategy is, for us, the link between policy and action in warfare. We're looking at it more, though. It's not just means, ways, and ends. That is a very tactical way of looking at the battle space. We're looking at how you get those ends provided. Who makes up what those ends are? Who provides for you the material, which is your means, and limits and enables the way in which you can operate at the tactical level, the ways. We're looking at strategy, therefore, not so much as goal-driven. In fact, one of the arguments that I'll make is the idea of an end state, which includes victory, is not appropriate for strategy, but it is purpose-driven. Purpose provides the grammar of war with a particular logic from politics. Strategy never ends. And if you have an end state, no matter how far out it is in the future, we're beginning to look at that as a tactical application, no matter how far it goes. Victory, then, is meaningless in strategy. Victory is one of many outcomes that can happen in strategy. And this is because the war will not end. Thus, strategy is a plan for continuing advantage, and I'll try to show you very quickly how I'm coming to that. The goal of strategy is not to culminate events. That is the goal of tactics. The goal of tactics being to put your opponent in such a situation where they have no choice but to surrender or be defeated to die on the battlefield. That is the apex of tactical skill. In strategy, however, even after that battlefield, events will continue on. Dialogue with the state, with the military, et cetera, that you're going on will continue on. So how you achieve that victory is much different to a strategist than to a tactician. We can look at it as starting out as a continuum of a way of thinking for the military professional. Decision making is when you decide what it is you're going to take to, what it is you're going to wear in the morning, what it is you're going to, whether you're going to bring an umbrella if it rains. I'll use a very trite example here of brushing my teeth. I brush my teeth. I make a decision that I'm going to do it twice a day. I'm going to floss once a day. And then after a while, that just sort of becomes habit. I understand that as a useful thing to do. And a valuable thing to do, and less offensive to my colleagues when I do it. Critical thinking is the next step in which you're looking at all kinds of options. What are other things that I might do? What toothpaste might I choose? Maybe I go three times a day. Maybe I only need to brush one time a day. What are all the options that I have? Maybe I'll use a sonic blaster for my teeth instead of a brush. We move on there to strategic thinking. Now, strategic thinking is going to look now at outcomes. One of the best things that's been done for the practical part of strategy making as means, ways, ends is to add potentials of risk. While critical thinking is looking at options that can get you where you want to be, strategic thinking is now what's going to happen because of your type of activity. And this is important for strategy because with decision making, it could be a game against nature. I'll make a decision and the reactions to that are immaterial to my decision. At the time I get to strategic thinking with a thinking opponent, what I do changes the opponent's behavior in some way. And finally, to thinking like a strategist. And this is where you're getting into looking at why you're brushing your teeth. What's the purpose of brushing your teeth? And if you miss a day, how much does that matter? Like a victory, do you have to win every battle on the battlefield? What happens if you win every battle and yet you still lose the war? Thinking like a strategist is looking for that continuing advantage. You're brushing your teeth every day to be healthier. It's a part of a health exercise. There's no end to that. It doesn't continue. There's no point. You can say, my teeth are fine. I don't have to brush anymore. That just doesn't happen. Think like a strategist is going to go beyond that. So we then look at the purpose of military power. We start with the national interest at the strategy level. And the national interest for every state is to acquire and then expand, maintain and expand the economic and security interests of that state. It's the same for every state, regardless of how they are constructed. Each state has a variety of means to do that. We look at the typical dime construct, diplomatic, informational, military, and economic power. I'm going to look at just the military side of it. In theory, I can take that out. Of course, they all work together. And the military purpose at the highest level of strategy is to be prepared and when called upon by the legitimate governing authority to maximize violence within the limits provided by that political authority. This does not mean the purpose of the military is to fight and win wars. That would be ridiculous, because then any time we're not fighting and winning a war, we would not be fulfilling our purpose. In fact, if we are prepared to fight and maximize violence, we do that on the hope that we won't have to fight. That that preparedness, that constant readiness for war, which you're involved in here, I see many of the ROTC students, is part of that preparation not to fight. At the operational level, we're looking at the various mediums of war. For land, we often hear you need boots on the ground. If you're going to control territory, if part of your goal is to control territory, you have to occupy the land. You can only control it from there. So the purpose of land power is to seize and hold territory. Probably can't quite read that. Seize and hold territory and then contest the littorals around it. It's perfectly legitimate for army land units to be able to fire on overflying aircraft to keep them from flying unhindered over their airspace. But even from the air, you cannot control the medium of the air unless you're in it. And that's someplace I'll go a little bit farther with on some questions. We are looking now at space power, and I'm going to talk a little bit later about space power, and the ability to guarantee our operations in space requires us to be in space with the capacity to execute violence there, if so directed. And possibly for cyber too, we'll go along with the same logic, if that is a new domain for war. And what does a virtual domain of warfare look like? And now my colleague, Mike Powell.
Thank you. We're going by height, apparently. You can feel free to laugh. I mean, this is not supposed to be stoic or painful.
Feel free to be funny.
Thank you. I'm here to talk to you about gray zones and hybrid war. You're all doing some sort of military training. You're probably doing military history classes. You're probably dealing with this new concept in the peace and war studies. Well, peace and war is not necessarily a binary. And there's a lot of bleed over. And now up in Washington, D.C., we're talking about things like hybrid war in gray zones, and people are wrestling with and struggling with these concepts because it's not clear where all the modern warfare of the 21st century falls in this dichotomy, if you will, of peace and war. Because it's really, really hard to discuss and define what peace is. It's really hard to define what war is, so I'm going to add some things that makes it even more difficult and harder to understand. But right now, up in D.C., people, and especially in the Department of Defense, and defense intellectuals, I love that title when they call us that, but we're dealing with this idea of what is a gray zone and what is a hybrid war. And what it is somewhere between the conventional conflicts that we used to have, like the Second World War, which was cool with airplanes and tanks and armies in uniforms fighting each other. We have something that's not quite conventional war, but it's definitely not peace, right? In the middle, there's this really weird sort of thing that's emerging, where you have conflict and violence, but it might be non-uniform. And we start talking about things like non-state actors and super-empowered individuals. And so it's going to include a lot of different variables that no longer fit within the conventional concept and no longer fit within the peace concept. And so Ev, as a political scientist, talks a lot about deterrence, and he's going to get into that. But there is some sort of conflict that's going on. So I have to give you a little bit of an overview of what is being talked about, even if I can't give you concrete definitions. Does that start to make sense? I hope so. So here we go. Somewhere in this gray zone or hybrid war concept are these special warfare campaigns. At the stabilizing effect, we're talking about foreign internal defense, where a country will go in and try to stabilize another country by advising them on how to be secure. And this isn't a new concept. This has been going on for thousands of years. But right now, military historians, political scientists, defense analysts are trying to wrestle with it in new ways because new variables are being introduced into the equation. I'll get to that on the next slide. But there's also the destabilizing side of this argument, which is the unconventional warfare side, which is incredibly ambiguous. And nobody has a really, really good definition of it. Within the Department of Defense itself, there's seven or eight definitions for unconventional warfare. The Air Force has one, the Army has one, Special Operations Forces have one, the State Department has one. Nobody has really come to a definite conclusion about what unconventional war is. Well, we could say it's unconventional, so it's not conventional, but it gets really, really ambiguous as to what exactly we're talking about. So let me add a couple of variables. Boom! Yes, I'm magic in a bad way. There we go, I'm back. Somewhere between irregular warfare, as it's defined by the Department of Defense, and conventional warfare, as it's defined again by the Department of Defense, we have this hybrid concept, which includes a number of things that are specific to the 21st century, but not necessarily always specific to the 21st century. The last component is the cyber thing that Paul will get up and talk about in a little bit, but that's new for us. And the DoD is trying to wrestle with where the virtual domain fits inside a definition of war and not war. I'm actually writing a theoretical piece right now on how we can define cyber and whether it is war or not war when somebody attacks us in the virtual realm. But that's where people say, well, it's not war. But maybe it is war, so we're going to throw it in the hybrid bin because we don't understand it yet. As well, there's a bit of conventional. You have guns and you have tanks, possibly. Light armored vehicles, you have bombs, you might have air power. Drones fits in nicely to this conventional concept, although they could be unconventional as well. It might have an irregular component. There are now the criminality component where you have organized crime that's getting into a very violent aspect and trying to make headway into defining themselves. And so you have an organization like ISIS, who we would like to just call a bunch of criminals or terrorists or maybe super empowered individuals, and super empowered individuals also fit into the cyber world. But they're not really conventional. They don't wear uniforms. We don't know how we fit into the Geneva Code when we deal with them. We don't know how we're going to deal with them either conventionally or irregularly. And they're very hard to define. And so the DoD is coming along and they're saying, well, that's hybrid war. Okay, well, a lot of things fit inside this concept. And we're going to have to keep struggling with it and thinking about it and writing about it and discussing it to get some really good ideas about how to define it before we can even deal with it. And so the thing that we do with our majors and lieutenant colonels in our classes is try to help define the problem so that we can take the Air Force, it's a big, huge, big blue, and try to apply it to the problems that we face around the world. So let me tell you where around the world we're talking. There. Hybrid war is all over that thing, okay? Central and South America, you have super-empowered individuals, you have criminal organizations, you've been reading about the northern border of Mexico, narco-terrorism. It's a bit awkward, it might fit into our categorization of what we're talking about here. South America, you have insurgencies and civil wars, which fit into the classic political science concept of civil wars, but not really, and they're getting more powerful, and they're also being defeated. But they're having an influence on the politics of the states of the countries in Central and South America. Sub-Saharan Africa is a nightmare, and we in the Department of Defense are going to have to keep continuing to deal with that for the foreseeable future, because there are religious components, there are economic components, there are state and non-state actor components, there are all kinds of problems. Then there's the resources, like in uranium in the Congo, which is important for a number of people that they want to sell, a lot of people want to buy, and there's a struggle, power struggle over the raw materials. Okay, so Sub-Saharan Africa. The Middle East continues to be a hotbed for hybrid war and gray zones. The far side of Europe, and I'm gonna give you an example in just a second, which a specific example, all through Southeast Asia and North Asia, I mean North Korea specifically, where they're trying to do something that's not quite conventional, but they're still trying to enforce or project power at their neighbors to get political concessions. So let me give you two examples really quickly. Russia and Crimea. The Baltic states are part of NATO, and so Moscow and Russia are not really going to try to mess with them too much, although they are getting into the hybrid war gray zone conflict with cyber. The 2008 or 10 on Estonia. 2007 cyber attack on Estonia was an example of trying to figure out how far the Russians could go without enacting a NATO Article 5 in support of Estonia. When Russia held a referendum, I'll use that word very loosely, in Crimea, and the Crimeans voted 104% in favor of rejoining Russia, it became an international incident because nobody wanted the Russians to have the Crimea back, and now the Russians are using troops but not in uniform, so gray zone hybrid war again, in the Ukrainian provinces of the Donetsk Basin, and we in the Western world and NATO are really having a tough time trying to figure out what our military, diplomatic, the dime, diplomatic and informational, military and economic responses will be to Russia for what they're doing in this part of the world. A lot of people in NATO are saying, well, it's a good thing we never let Ukraine into NATO, because then we would have to do something about it. Right now we're trying to figure out what we can do about it, both at the United States level, but also the NATO level and the United Nations level. And so it's an example of conflict. It's definitely not peace, but it's not really war. And so we're trying to figure out where it is in the spectrum of conflict, and so we're calling it a gray zone or hybrid war. And so that makes it very difficult, because it's hard for the politicians and the military thinkers and planners to figure out how we want to respond to it. So let me give you one more example, and then I'll get off the stage and let everybody else talk so we can get more Q&A. China in the South China Sea. And this one is fascinating. Whereas the Russians are using fairly traditional military equipment, some cyber power, and they're trying to make their inroads into the Ukraine, the Chinese are absolutely brilliant in the South China Sea. They're going and they're physically building up islands so that they can be big enough to put an air base on it, and then they can say, well, we have people there, it's ours, obviously. The Nine Dash Line, which they define as their purview in the South China Sea, borders on all of these other countries and their claims on the same areas. Now, it's fairly resource rich. There's the potential for fish, but also oil and deep sea mining. And so the Chinese want to say that this is all theirs. And these other countries, Malaysia, Brunei, Philippines, Vietnam, also say that it's theirs. And so there's a diplomatic conflict over the area in the South China Sea that the Chinese have defined for the last about 1,000 years as their part of the world. And so what they're doing is they're building up locations, military bases, very, very small ones, with ADIZ, aircraft denial something, something, some zones. Who knows what ADIZ stands for?
Aircraft identification zones.
Thank you. I know the acronym, I don't remember what it stands for. Okay, they're building up areas and military presence in the South China Sea in order to diplomatically keep other people from moving in there. It's kind of sneaky, makes sense at a political level, but the Americans are like, well, we don't want you to do that. So there's this very interesting dynamic on the South China Sea where the Chinese are not necessarily violent, they're just building up islands, but they're preventing anyone else from using them and the resources in that area. So it's sort of war, but not really. And it's kind of peaceful, but not really. So again, it's falling in this middle bin of hybrid war gray zones. It's very, almost quite literally a gray zone, where there is competition, economic and diplomatic, but we really are having, we the United States again, we our allies in the Pacific, are having a really difficult time trying to figure out what our responses will be. And that's the fascinating part of gray zones and hybrid war. Because with a conventional attack, if the Russians roll into the Baltic states or roll into Poland, we have a very obvious response that we will mount. NATO Article 5, fire up the A-10s, let's go. Right? Air Force crowd, come on. A-10s? Coolest airplane ever built, by the way. Okay. Conventional war is easy and straightforward. It's difficult and a lot of people die, but it's pretty easy. We know what we're doing there. We're really, really good at it. Peace, we're also really good at. We love our NATO friends. We love our allies in the Pacific. That hybrid gray war, the hybrid war gray zones component is what's really, really difficult. It's absolutely fascinating, and it's one of the things that we wanted to come and talk to you today about what you are going to have to be dealing with when you leave here, commission, and come into our Air Force, and hopefully someday make it to ACSC. Thanks for your time. We'll wait your questions.
All right. So for the last 350 years, we've had a pretty basic understanding of what war is, when the term applies, how it works. And a lot of that understanding was established really in the mid-17th century. We understood war to mean an armed conflict between nation states. And our understanding of war came with a whole host of expectations, what you could and could not do in conflict. And for the most part, these definitions of what's acceptable in terms of going to war and what's acceptable once you're in a war have been relatively static. You start looking at the ways that we define war, legally, politically, philosophically, there's a lot of real consistency in our conflicts. But in the 21st century, we're starting to see that there are a lot of actors out there that have very little interest in playing by the rules that were established by the most powerful states on Earth, largely for the benefit of those powerful states on Earth. If you want to become a new player in the world geopolitical sphere, you probably don't want to play by the same rules that have allowed nations like the United States, Russia, and China to attain primacy, particularly if you are a non-state actor, such as the Islamic State, Al-Qaeda, pick any non-state actor that's bent upon conquest, expansion, and transformation of the world, and you'll find one of the underpinnings of their approach to conflict is an attempt to break up our understanding of what war is. One of the ways that we're seeing that really erupt in the 21st century is through the incorporation of new technology and the concept of the cyber domain, unmanned platforms, and the possibility of machines going to war with one another. Now ask yourself this simple question. How do you make people smarter? You can educate people, you can teach them new things, but is it possible to actually make humans smarter than they are today? There's a little bit of psychological evidence to suggest that humans have actually become slightly smarter over the course of the last 50 years, though the current political atmosphere may suggest that that change isn't necessarily happening in the United States. But in reality, humans, for all intents and purposes, are about as smart now. Their capability for taking in new information, transforming it, reacting to unforeseen circumstances, we're about as smart now as we've ever been, but we're also about as dumb now as we've ever been. Computers, on the other hand, have been massively increasing exponentially their processing power, their capacity for what we might deem intelligence. And by being an artificial intelligence, it's possible to make these machines smarter and smarter. At a certain point, the non-human intelligence on the planet is likely to surpass human capacity. And when that happens, we're going to have an awful lot of decisions to make about conflict, about how societies interact with one another, and about how this is going to influence the interaction of humans. That's where the cyber domain comes in. Cyber is the first man-made domain. We didn't invent land, space, sea, air, but cyber we did. And when we invented it, we weren't really thinking a lot about human conflict and how states might use this as a means to influence, coerce, or hurt other state actors. But what we're seeing, unsurprisingly, is that when you give humans a new toy, they will find ways to use it for their own advantage. A simple example comes to mind. In 1981, the Israelis got wind of the fact that the Iraqis were building a nuclear reactor and were bent upon developing nuclear weapons. Given that the Iraqi dictator Saddam Hussein had announced a predilection for destroying Israel, and that Iraq had gone to war against Israel twice in recent memory, the Israelis decided this was an unacceptable threat. They launched a massive airstrike and they destroyed the reactor complex. They were effectively illustrating for the Iraqis and anyone else in the region that was watching that Israel would not tolerate nuclear weapons in the Middle East in the hands of any regime that had professed a hostility to the existence of the Israeli state. In the year 2007, the Israelis got wind that the Syrians were building a nuclear reactor. Syria had also gone to war three times against the Israelis in three separate conflicts. And the Israelis decided they were not going to tolerate the existence of a Syrian nuclear reactor. However, the Syrians had also imported a first-rate air defense system. They had actually purchased it from the Russians, and the Israelis weren't all that certain that their aircraft were going to be able to penetrate that system and destroy the reactor. So what did they do? They launched a cyber attack. They actually used human operators to maneuver into Syria and to upload through a fiber optic system a virus. And that virus effectively shut down the Syrian air defense network. It effectively spoofed a return on the radars that suggested there's nothing to see here. There aren't any Israeli F-16s flying overhead. When in reality, that's exactly what was happening. The first warning the Syrians had that they were under attack was the detonation of precision-guided munitions on their nuclear reactor. Now, this particular attack destroyed the facility. The Syrians, who had constructed this without any sanction from the rest of the world, quickly bulldozed the site, denied that there had ever been any nuclear materials there, and accused the Israelis for some unknown reason of attacking an empty patch of ground, which is not a normal behavior, but, you know, if you're going to tell a lie, tell a big lie. Go all the way. So, why does this matter? Because cyber enabled the Israelis to conduct an attack that they weren't sure they could do without the cyber domain. And it demonstrated that you could actually utilize cyber in support of a kinetic strike. It was a very effective demonstration of what an advanced cyber power could do against a less advanced cyber-capable opponent. However, Iran is too far away from Israel for this type of an airstrike, particularly because when the Israelis found out about the Iranian nuclear program, the United States was still actually enforcing a no-fly zone over Iraq and made it clear to the Israelis that we would not tolerate an Israeli air flight over Iraqi airspace. In other words, we weren't going to let the Israelis take the most obvious route to launch an airstrike against the Iranian nuclear facility, even though we might have thought it served our best interest to see that facility destroyed. So a kinetic strike is out. Even if the Israelis had the capacity to do it, they didn't have the backing from the rest of the world, and once again, they weren't certain that they would actually be able to carry out a kinetic strike. There's an awful lot of people in the world that would prefer not to see Iran in possession of a nuclear weapon. We're not 100% certain who created the most sophisticated computer attack in history, though the New York Times claimed in 2011 that certain signatures pointed to either the United States or Israel or both. We're also not 100% certain how the virus was uploaded. What we do know is that somebody created a computer program that would effectively spread itself through computer networks, would search for a very specific type of computer that is designed to control industrial hardware. That industrial hardware needed to be equipped with a Farsi keyboard, in other words, a keyboard that would be used probably only in Iran, and that particular type of hardware was designed to effectively support centrifuges that were being used for the enrichment of uranium. When the program found that type of hardware, it made a minor alteration in the way that that hardware worked that would effectively cause the centrifuges to speed up and slow down on a rhythmic fashion rather than running at one unique speed. By doing that, they effectively induced a vibration within the system that over time broke down the centrifuges, but left no physical evidence of exactly why the centrifuges were breaking down. Given that the Iranians had imported all of their nuclear materials and all of their centrifuge technology, they didn't actually have the technological know-how to realize what was happening, why it was happening, or how they might prevent it. It wasn't until a couple of years later when a very obscure antivirus company in Belarus announced that it had discovered, and I'm using the term discovered with air quotes here, it had discovered a new, very sophisticated cyber attack that the world became aware of what is now referred to as Stuxnet. We're certain Stuxnet is the product of a nation state. Only a nation possesses enough cyber resources to have put together this kind of a sophisticated code. This is not something that some hacker living in their parents' basement is going to put together. It relied upon four separate, previously unknown exploits within Microsoft software. That is an unheard of amount of investment for a single piece of software. What this demonstrated was that it might be possible to launch an attack on an enemy without any kinetic assets involved and have the exact same effect as if you had bombed the site. But is that an act of war? We know dropping bombs on enemy territory, destroying their property, possibly killing human beings, is an act of war. But we're not 100% certain whether a cyber attack is or is not. Most cyber attacks can be turned off Once the enemy is coerced into whatever it is you want them to do, you can often stop the damage and entirely reverse it. So we're not certain where cyber fits into this nation-state concept of how wars are launched and when they should be defined as wars. And that's going to be a problem for your generation, not mine. I am anticipating death. The sooner the better, so that I can avoid these problems. See, that's how you get them to laugh. As soon as they envision you dead, everybody's happy. Okay, now in military robotics, we have another similar problem. We generally define war in terms of its effect upon humanity. And we generally assume that wars involve humans trying to kill other humans. But what if your conflict involves machines? Particularly if it only involves machines destroying other machines, is this really war or is it something else? And we have become very sophisticated in our employment of unmanned military technology. Some of the things that we're using on the battlefield today are absolutely terrifying. This is the kind of stuff that keeps me awake at night. But a lot of this technology is dual use. It's also got some wonderful applications. For example, if you look on the lower left-hand corner, there's an individual who lost his arm in an IED attack in Iraq in 2005. He is now connected to a hand, a mechanical hand, that he is capable of controlling with his mind. In 2015, it was surgically attached to his arm. He is now capable of picking up an egg with the artificial hand and cracking it with one hand, which gives you an idea of the kind of precision that this particular device contains. He can do that with his eyes closed. He can actually feel the egg, thanks to force feedback technology coming back into his brain. That's awesome. That's fantastic. That's super helpful. Until you decide that artificial limbs are more powerful, more useful, and better, and if you want to join, say, a special forces organization, you'll have to sacrifice your arms and your legs so we can upgrade you to better technology. Seems implausible, right? But then you start to think about the different things humans have done to make themselves more efficient in conflict. How many teenagers would you say would be willing to have a cell phone implanted in their brain to save them the trouble of actually looking down on it and having to dial? Because Google is looking into that very technology right now. One of the things that Google has designed are contact lenses that function in the same way that Google Glass. You remember the Google Glasses, the horrifically ugly glasses that nobody liked and creeped everybody out? Imagine doing that with contact lenses instead. You would have no idea whether somebody's accessing technology right in front of you or not. As a college professor, it's my nightmare because cheating will never be easier than if you're wearing contact lenses that allow you to look up the answers to everything I put in front of you. Awesome. Okay, so where we're going. What we're seeing is a massive expansion in computing power. And that massive expansion is allowing us, in turn, to then expand what we can do on the battlefield with this new form of technology. Right now, there is no nation state on Earth that is currently employing autonomous lethal weapons. In other words, nobody is using weapons that actually decide for themselves whether or not they're going to kill. There is a limited exception to that statement in the form of certain air defense mechanisms, but even those tend to have a human operator that's directly involved in the decision whether or not to fire. However, we have seen the development of machines that are perfectly capable of making those decisions on their own. In the 1990s, we saw the first attempt to do this. That's actually shown in the lower right-hand corner there. The LOCAST system was actually a fire-and-forget aircraft that essentially would fly over the battlefield for about 4 hours looking for targets. Now, at the time, its targets were largely defined as Soviet-era tanks, and its job was to fly around, look down, and destroy tanks from the air under the assumption that a tank that was built in the Soviet Union is never a good thing because we don't buy those, and we don't allow our friends to buy those, so therefore this was a great plan. It didn't work. It kept hitting the same tanks over and over and over again. It would hit all kinds of things that weren't tanks, but that kind of vaguely looked like a tank to its little tiny robot brain. That was in the 1990s. Bear in mind, computer technology doubles in its computing capacity about every 18 months. So start doing the math. You've doubled the computing capacity of these machines 15 times. Anybody know what 2 to the 15th power is off the top of their head? 32,000, good job. Yeah, 32,000 times more intelligent than what we had 20 years ago. Now, on the lower left-hand side, what we see is a very advanced facial recognition system. Thank you, Hitachi, for coming up with this thing that can actually compare over 30 million faces in a minute. Now, I want you to think about what happens when you marry the LOCAS that flies around and decides to shoot without a human involved with a facial recognition system that can compare the population of Texas every minute. You program that thing with the faces of all the people you want to kill, and then you just start launching it over enemy territory. You can see the ramifications of this. But is that war? If a machine kills, is that war? If a machine kills in a way that we would consider illegal, is that a war crime? And if so, how do you punish a machine for committing a war crime? The unfortunate ramification of this technology is that you are enabling the practice of war crimes because you have no mechanism to enforce the laws that you devised in an era when these things did not exist. And we're only expanding the technology. We're moving into swarm concepts. We're making these things smaller and smaller. Imagine a swarm of robots that are each less than 1 ounce that are carrying a half ounce of plastic explosive. They're perfectly capable of flying almost anywhere and detonating themselves in close proximity to whatever their target might be. They exist. Those are not hard to deploy. So you can see how this new technological frontier is going to create a whole lot of ethical and legal challenges for us. And that's a huge subject of how we're going to go about warfare in the 21st century. The logical extreme, if you've seen the Terminator movies, you know what happens, right? Computers get too smart and they rise up and they take us over. There's really no way to ensure that that won't happen. Quite frankly, when computers become more intelligent than humans, good luck outthinking them and how you're going to program them and how you're going to plug every loophole. So again, I embrace death, and in the meantime, I look forward to bowing down before our robot overlords. Sir.
Well, I want one of those... We have a little bit more here.
Right. More.
I want
right.
one of those.
Little space. Little space.
I want one of those telephones in my brain. I want to jack in. I'm going to look at space strategy here for a moment because outer space has been an area that, as far as the question we've had over the last 30 years or so, particularly, is whether or not we should even bring warfare into this pristine domain where only the best and brightest have gone. Well, we've had warfare there for several. Since the first Sputnik went in 1957, we've had warfare in space, contestation in space, and we're continuing to do that. And the most important thing for us right now is that no nation on Earth relies more on space and space capabilities than the United States. Your cell phones work because of it right now, because of timing signals that go out. The internet allows for secure transactions, so you can buy things. GPS tracking allows wholesale changes in economic ways of doing work. Just-in-time supply happens because of it. Communications in hard-to-reach areas, cell phones can't go everywhere, are dependent upon space power. And so dependent is our military on space power that should some tremendous sequence of events, say a massive solar flare combined with perhaps a launch into space of a dirty nuke into the upper atmosphere on a Scud missile, for which about 25 states have the capability of, if it's not a nuke, just debris in space that could start taking out satellites. If the United States were to lose its space power today, we would have to hunker down into a defensive crouch and begin withdrawing from all the areas we are in the world. We simply could not operate for several years efficiently and effectively enough to protect ourselves around the world. So the United States Air Force has the job, has the mission to ensure that the United States and anyone else with peaceful intentions has access to space in times of peace, and that the United States and our allies' enemies cannot access space in times of conflict or war. But we're not allowed to use any weapons there. That's currently the way it is. Can you imagine the Navy having that? In fact, the Navy does have that mission for the open seas. To guarantee peaceful access to the open seas all over the world, except outside of the territorial zones of other states. And in times of conflict, to deny that access to opponents. Now, can you imagine the Congress saying to the United States Navy, but do that without any warships. No guns, no capability to extract, to put violence there. Well, I think the Navy would say, have someone else do that. And so the real question we need to debate here is The United States Air Force is trying to come up with ideas, trying to come up with capabilities that, should it be tasked with protecting assets in space and denying access to an opponent, how will it do this job? It is a martial organization. Can it do the job without weapons in space? So should we be, don't blame the U.S. Air Force for trying to look at things like this. Blame the people who gave them the mission without allowing them to use their own capability. Maybe State Department should have that mission or something like that. At any rate, we need to keep going with the propriety of this. And I'm going to try to make a case that we need to weaponize space. It's a difficult case to make, given that we don't see war in space. The war in space will not be televised. Every week, the United Nations receives, because they are the overseers of deconflicting space for all nations who want to use it, receives about 200 reports from space users of intentional interference with their satellites on orbit. Now, some of these are no doubt natural occurrences. Some of them are glitches and things that they can't figure out. But the United Nations does say that about 5 of those episodes per week are intentional interference with other satellites. Is war in space really likely? I've got a quote up here from a Chinese specialist. I'm going to use China. I don't think it's likely that China and the United States are going to go to war, but if they do, I'll try to make the case that it will start in outer space. We have to look at space a little bit differently. Now, this is a geopolitical look at space. Imagine gravity as your deep wells and your high rises in space. If you were to take, say, the near Earth area of space onto a rubberized sheet and then put the heaviest objects in there, and they would create these deep wells in space. This is, you look out at space and you say, well, we can go in any direction. You know, it's kind of like Star Wars and the Millennium Falcon takes off, or I'm a Star Trek guy, so it doesn't make me happy. But you go up through space, you go off in any direction, you hide behind planets. It just doesn't work that way. Gravity is what defines the terrain of space. And if you look at this in a sort of traditional intelligence preparation of the battle space or something like that, we can look at space as having unique areas, unique zones of travel, paths that get followed because of efficiency, etc. You can look at outer space in a traditional military way, such that you even start looking at outer space in this kind of a gravity well. And this shows you the difference in gravity between the Earth and the Moon. For example, if you were to go out tonight and take a look at what's left of the Moon, it's waning, I believe, and get a 30-06 rifle and take a shot at it, what do you think the chance of hitting the Moon are? Zero. It's not going to get out of the atmosphere. However, if you're on the Moon and you have that very same rifle and you shoot towards the Earth, there's a good chance you'll hit it. That's the difference in propulsive power that it takes. For example, if I'm going from the Earth to the Moon, about 60% of my fuel usage to get to the Moon is just getting out of the gravity well, getting about 300 miles above the surface of the Earth. This is not a distance here. This is gravity, or delta V, the change in velocity required to move. So the Earth sits at the bottom of this gravity well, as you can see, and low Earth orbit is right about here. In other words, items about 100, 110 miles above the Earth are circling the Earth every 90 minutes. If you were to drop a rock towards the Earth, by the time it hit, and if it could survive, let's use a depleted uranium rod so that it at least survives reentry in the heat of reentry. It would come in with such kinetic force, just simply being dropped, that if this rod was, say, a yard long and about that big around, it would liquefy on the way in. It would still hit concrete, hardened concrete, and penetrate about 100 feet of hardened concrete. An almost nuclear effect without any radius blast. However, trying to get up from there is extraordinarily difficult and requires a lot of effort and time just to get up there. This is the new high ground. This is the new high ground. This has the same advantages that high ground has always had. And if you can seed low Earth orbit with several dozen, or ideally even several thousand small satellites, you could actually create a blockade on the Earth. There is no way to get to anywhere in that large map. Anything that's higher than that, even the geostationary satellites that provide all of our television and weather monitoring, without going up through this well.
the whole of Earth is simply a point in space from this perspective. And we've been looking at that, as you can see from this, since at least the early 1950s. As soon as the first space launch came, both the Soviet Union and the United States began deploying capabilities to contest this environment, and have been doing so for some time. The idea is whoever could control that highest ground would have the same advantage as whoever controls the airspace above the battlefield. It can be, or should be, decisive on a global scale. This is an artist conception in the upper left-hand corner of the first operational anti-satellite weapon, the Soviet Union's Korabl ASAT. This is essentially a 5,000-pound shotgun shell that the Soviet Union would fire up into orbit, get it within 5 kilometers, heading towards a target satellite, detonate, and about 50% of the time, one of those bits would hit the satellite and disable it. They tested it a couple of dozen times from the 1960s through the 1970s and into the early 1980s. Interestingly, this is the latest model. We had to use artist conceptions in the Cold War. The latest model is down there on display of this same sort of thing. The launch vehicle, you can see in the lower left, if you remember the space shuttle explosion from 1987 that occurred because the O-rings, it got close to freezing, 32 degrees, it was a very cold night in Florida, and that caused a catastrophic failure. You can see these are the Russians are launching these vehicles from north of Moscow in below zero temperatures. Also, this this very interesting thing here, these missiles that these ASATs are launched on are produced, I've been told, like sausages, and they're solid. They're railed out and then hoisted up like this. Whereas our vehicles, if we tried to do that, would bust apart. They're very solid, they're very war resistant, and they're still available in the Russian, now Russian arsenal. Our response to that, practically, was to do a number of ideas, and I'll show you a few of those, but we got an F-15 launched ASAT. In other words, the aircraft would go up to its highest possible altitude, launch an anti-air missile at a satellite, and we had a direct hit on that. Now, the Chinese then have also followed up in that, and this is their an artist conception of their interceptor. And in 2007, the Chinese began hitting and destroying satellites in outer space, their own satellites, our own satellites, etc. And each of these countries, the United States, the Chinese, the Russians, in their first engagement, made a whole cloud of debris that became a real problem. Since then, they have simply engaged in a direction towards the Earth so that all of that debris comes in and burns up. Space war does not have to be disastrous in that sense, as some people have argued. And now we're looking at other such things as lasers and directed energy weapons as most effective. The United States responded by launching an anti-missile missile off of an Aegis cruiser to show the Chinese that while your launches could come from your own territory, our launches can come from not only anywhere in the air, but anywhere at sea that we can put an Aegis launcher to ratchet that up. The Soviet Union always believed that the United States space shuttle was a military craft. It'd be a very expensive one, but we had a Canadian manipulator arm on that experimental craft that you could go up, fly next to a satellite, retrieve it, bring it home, fix it, and then launch it and go again. That would be an effective satellite interceptor. So they built their own shuttle. This is the Buran, or Snowstorm, that they built, flying on top of one of their Antonov liners, very much like a 747, in response to that so that they could match the capability that we had in that area. We've also done some other things. We have airborne lasers, chemical lasers designed to get high above the Earth, to have a less air distribution on a laser shot to take out satellites. This is the Soviet version of that same thing that we in the United States Air Force have. This is the Miracle Laser in New Mexico, a massive powered ground-based laser that can fire into space, and we use it to measure the distance between satellites and the Earth, and that's a good enough reason. This is kind of interesting. We've had a number of space fighters. The United States has recently deployed something called the X-37B. It's an unmanned mini shuttle, it looks like, but it wasn't the first one. This is a MiG-105 from the 1960s. Actually test flown by the second man in space,
German, the Russian, who followed into the secondary. And a very sophisticated looking airplane now on display in museums around Moscow, but it was designed to take off horizontally and go into space, or to be launched from the top of one of those aircraft and go into space. Of course, we responded in the 1960s with something called Dinosaur. Probably not a great name for the high-tech capability that's coming out, but this was the Boeing Dinosaur, and we spent about $1 billion trying to develop this in the 1960s, which doesn't sound like a lot of money, but after a while, you know, it adds up, a billion there. And, but at the time, it was a very, very expensive project. This would be launched on the nose of a rocket. This is the current U.S. X-37D. As you can see, it looks very much like a mini space shuttle, and it has done a number of missions in outer space, testing capabilities. It stayed up almost 2 years recently, came back to Earth, and was able to do some good scientific experiments. This shows how it is in the shroud of a missile that is ready to go up, of a rocket launch vehicle that's ready to go up. So these are some of the kinds of things that have been developed. Again, we have the X-37B. This is the Chinese Shenlong autonomous or remotely piloted space vehicle, which is launched from under the wing of an aircraft. And this is the new United Nations space plane / space fighter, whatever you want to call it, the Dream Chaser, that is supposed to be start testing in 2 years and has been purchased by the United Nations. So that's some really fascinating things that are going on there. I like to think of, and I'll get back to China now, because we look at China and its expansionist efforts in the South China Sea, what they're doing, how they're responding to global events. And one of the things that they're doing is building the capability to deny the U.S. the access, the ability to see into China or into its area around China in times of crisis. If the United States does not have the capability to see into China, to see what's going on, say, for an example, an attempt to take a hostile takeover of the island of Taiwan, where the United States usually responds by putting aircraft carriers in between Taiwan and the mainland to basically to get those things blown up. If China were to somehow take Taiwan quickly, the United States might not necessarily want to go to potentially nuclear war over that event. However, if there's an aircraft carrier with 6,000 people on it and its associated ships, and that gets sunk, we would probably think very hard about going to war. So the Chinese are very different in the way that we in the United States look at transparency as a confidence building measure. If I can see what you're doing, you can see what I'm doing, then we have time to negotiate. We don't have to worry. We don't have to be on high alert all the time. This is a Western way of looking at things. The Eastern way, the Asian way, is very much as Sun Tzu said, never let your opponent know how strong or how weak you are. Full transparency is quite frightening, in fact, because then the opponent can lull you into a false sense of confidence and can determine how to defeat you in detail. If you're a bank robber, you'd love to have access to all the capabilities and all the plans and all the comings and goings of a bank. They would love to have complete control over you. That's why you, the bank robber, the ones they're most worried are not the tellers who are on their first week of duty, but the person who's been there 50 years and is just about to get a gold watch and has all the codes and keys. This is just a different way of looking at things. It doesn't seem very likely geopolitically that China is the greatest land power possibly the world has ever known. The United States is the greatest mobility power the world has ever known on air and sea. Neither of us can meaningfully look at taking over the other's territory. I can't imagine in the next two decades the United States having any kind of capability to occupy and pacify China. Certainly China wouldn't have the capability to come across the oceans and occupy and pacify us. We like the Chinese, we respect the Chinese, I think they like us and respect us as well. And yet, this two different types of government that look at the world in transparency so different, and this conflict in outer space, where we go with that, is there an ability? The first thing that we would think if the Chinese did attempt to blind our ability to see into China from space, we'd have to assume that was preparatory to some sort of action, and things could just go, nobody wants war, but that's how we still get them. I'm not gonna spend much more time on that because of, we need to give you some time for Q&A. There's some interesting stuff here that came up, and I too, for one, welcome our robot overlords.
Pile on, why don't you?
Yeah, piling on for you.
Second round of applause. We could go a little beyond the half hour. Let me, nominally half that, but let me ask one initial question. The common imagination of war, really back to time immemorial, is lots of people getting mobilized, in the past it was men, getting mobilized, getting armed, going out and fighting the foe. At home, there might also be some kind of mobilization, certainly in recent times of the civilian population. And protracted conflict going on for years, Civil War, First World War, Second World War, other wars before. Is that pretty much passé as a concept of how future wars will be formed? Anyone who wants to
start? Do you want me to start?
Go ahead.
Go ahead. No, it's not necessarily passé. We see that the modes of conflict that nation states choose change over time. And there's never been a time period where conventional war was the only type of war being fought. You can go back 2,000 years and see a series of rebellions and insurgencies, for example, against the Roman Empire. Now, the Roman response was quite a bit more heavy-handed than what we normally see here. The Romans had a tendency to attack any province in rebellion, sack all of its cities, slaughter all of its inhabitants, enslave the ones that they didn't slaughter, and you know, really prove a point that maybe rebelling against the Roman Empire was a bad idea. But no, I don't necessarily think that large-scale state-on-state conflict is gone forever, as nice as that might be. But currently, in the near future, it's a less likely form of conflict.
Well, since the large sort of movements of people around 1,000 years ago, there have really only been three real total sort of wars: the Napoleonic or actually 1648, 30 Years' War, the Napoleonic Wars, and then World War I, World War II time frame. And the norm has been really sort of small conflicts for small gains, quite often up until the last century for profit, for loot, for gains in those ways. The destructiveness of World War I and World War II made that idea of going to war for economic gain very, very difficult to justify. It might have happened in Desert Storm, but that's still very much arguable. But what we are seeing now is sort of a perpetual low level of war. There's, I'll just do something here. This was in white. The idea here is there's really a scale of war. And what you have is total war, in which actually victory does become the only thing that matters. And because if you don't win, the state is destroyed. In those cases, yeah, you're gonna get the whole of the people together, the whole of the state resources together. Unfortunately, we're at a point now where we could actually destroy the entire earth and nobody wins. And that's probably one of the reasons why we keep war at a much lower level these days. Less than that in limited wars, et cetera, are we looking at some sort of efficiency? We look at cost effectiveness. We're looking at the past 30 years of war. Have we really gotten much bang for that buck? And when you get into other areas that the military is being tasked with that are not necessarily violence, necessarily humanitarian aid, nation building, things that are really not the purpose of the military, but they're doing because they're there. They have resources in place, et cetera. Not necessarily something they should do, but something they can do. And we're adding to this now the pace and acceleration of change so quickly. One of the things we're looking at very much is reversible effects. We have smell weapons now that give horrible smells. The Israelis are very good at this. Mixes of feces and vomit and whatever that make you just make you dizzy. We have blinding, temporary blinding capabilities. We have really good, really interesting stuff with microwaves that can blow up roadside bombs. You know, but if you dial it down, can make people feel like they're on fire and might get them to drop their weapon, etc. Sometimes I wonder about those. Once you get the ability to defeat them and we're relying on them, does that cause more violence? One of the great questions that my colleagues and I deal with is if the ability we have from a distance to inflict pain or punishment on another individual or state, are we more likely to use that or even less? Or does that give us the detachment to use it with more thought rather than an emotional response? You know, when you get shot at, it makes you kind of angry. But if you're at a safe distance, can you sort of have some detachment from the emotion of it? Lots of these questions are coming up, but
The idea that the thing is the fear of that large war with so many states having nuclear capabilities or rising up to that level is going to tamp down the desire to do a lot of that. And yet, as I point out for space, we still have to be able to protect. Deterrence is great until it fails, and then it fails utterly. If the United States is attacked in space, we have no protection from that. If another state launches a missile at us today, we have no protection from that. We are relying entirely on a violent response to prevent attacks on us. And the great thing about deterrence is it always works until it fails. You can't prove it ever worked. You can only prove it fails.
Okay.
Sorry, I went too long.
That's all right. No, I'll just add one more thing to think about. There's a new, the new war theory is very popular right now amongst academics, especially coming out of London School of Economics, Mary Caldor specifically, New and Old Wars. And in it, she says that there is this lower level violence that's going to continue for much longer, and it's less likely that state will fight state, and cosmopolitan wars, and all these kinds of concepts with hybrid war. But you have to remember that there are still states that are out there that are quite violent and very, very threatening. If North Korea does something and we take offense to it and want to mount a response, that will be a classic state-on-state conventional, possibly nuclear war. So there's always the mechanism. And one of the things that we talk about with our students at ACSC is, if you only have this much money in your budget, in your DoD budget, do you have to plan? Do you plan for the force that can fight the conventional war, which is less likely but more risky, or do you plan for a force that can fight more conventional wars, which is more likely but less risky for existential the existential threat to the United States of America? And what we're dealing with right now is trying to come up with some sort of hybrid answer where we keep the strength and the deterrence that Ev talks about, but at the same time can deal with all the little things that are going wrong in the world. And so there's no easy answer, that's why I love my job. There's no easy answer, but it's really a great thought experiment to try to deal with these questions.
Well, and it's useful also. I mean, we have wars on Christmas now, and you know, wars on education, and all these things. And the problem with that is once you start calling them wars, then the military does have a legitimate place to be. And we just gotta stop doing that. War is violence between organized social groups with governing legitimacy. And that the military may have a role to play, depending on where you want to go with that. And so, you know, we look at international terrorism and the war on terror, and it really looks more like international crime and not a war. And so then what is the role of the military in policing? And that can be a very dangerous road to go down as well. So these are some of the issues that we look at, because in general, we agree that, as Clausewitz said, the nature of war is unchanging, but the context is always evolving. And so we're trying to understand the nature of war given this new context of technology, social change, rapid geopolitical change in weather, immigration, movements of people, and that sort of thing. Questions for the floor?
Out there. I'd like to hear a persuasive defense of the notion that the cyber attack against the Iranian nuclear reactor is in fact a case of hybrid war, that it is in fact one of these gray zones, because it seems to me that this is very clearly breaking people's stuff, which is an act of war.
Well, part of the issue is, but if you don't know who did it, it's very difficult to call it an act of war. In general, when somebody attacks you, you know who's responsible. But if you don't know for sure, and that's cyber, we really have an attribution problem. It is very difficult to be 100% certain who hit you. It's very easy to be certain you got hit, but it's also possible to mask who did it and to frame someone else. That's really kind of the ultimate objective, right? The lights go out, I punch Dolman, because we all want to, but I hit him in his right ear so he thinks Pavlik did it. Right, that's win-win for me. I get to hit him, and I don't get any retaliation.
You're evil.
I am. It's true. But you know, the question is not, was that an act of war? Assuming it was launched by a nation state, and I would argue it definitely was, yes, that was an act of war. The question is, who launched the war?
I guess my question is, how is clandestine sabotage different from it has been? Or sure. Since the onset of the war.
Let me, go ahead. But I would just say the net effect is the same, whether it was, I mean, it could have been an insurgent in Iran setting off a bomb and had the same effect. But in this case, it's not necessarily sabotage so much as a hostile act of destruction. It's not quite the same thing, but it's very close. Mike.
Sure, and the other thing I would say is not only the attribution part, but also the violent concept, the aspect of violence. Nobody died. Yeah, you break some stuff, but nobody died. The problem the Iranians, you need to start, I'm not going to say it that way. There's another way to think about the reaction to an act of war. Just because it's an act of war, which Paul would say it was, I would say it wasn't, so that's why we can disagree with each other. But even if it is an act of war, the Iranians have to say that it's an act of war and mount a response to it. Let me give you an example. China tries to hack the DoD 150,000 times a day right now. We tell them that they're doing it. They say, yeah, we're probably doing it, but we're not going to tell you we're doing it. But China's a huge, powerful entity, and we're not going to attack China over some OPM leaks, all right? The Estonians didn't want to attack the Russians for their act of war, cyber attack against the Estonians, because Russia's bigger and would crush them, right? The Iranians weren't willing to say that it was an act of war because they didn't want to have to fight against the people that probably did it. So follow me on the analogy. If Belize launches a cyber attack on the United States of America, we'll crush them. So they won't. That's the deterrent factor. But if it's a state, it's the perception component. So there's attribution, there's the violence and death and destruction component, but then there's the country that's been offended has to be able to say, well, this is an act of war and we're going to do something about it. And if they're not powerful enough to do something about it, then they won't say, well, that was an act of war and we're going to do something. That's where it becomes hybrid, because in a conventional attack, if we roll tanks, Saddam Hussein rolls tanks across the Iranian border in 1980, the 1980 to 1988 Iran-Iraq war, that was an act of war that the Iranians responded, chemical weapons and human wave attacks and all kinds of nastiness, that was obvious and attributable. In the case of Stuxnet, nobody's ever claimed responsibility. There was no death, although there was some destruction, but the perception from the Iranians was, what are we gonna do about it? We don't have the power.
But if you think of Stuxnet as part of a concentrated campaign, a lot of Iranian nuclear scientists started being assassinated shortly after Stuxnet was revealed. There were an awful lot of them that were killed, and it was not the state murdering their own scientists. But again, we weren't 100% certain who was responsible for these attacks, these murders. So if you think of it as part of a campaign where Stuxnet was just the opening gambit, then you start to see a hybridization there. Is assassination an act of war? Well, I could get angry enough. If I thought a foreign actor had tried to assassinate the president, that might be enough for the United States to declare war, but it's not inherently an act of war.
Well, and the United States hasn't declared war in 70 years. And so yep. An act of war is whatever you want it to be. And if you do, if you don't have an act of war, you'll make one up. I mean, there's that. I think the real thing here is, though, that, you know, it's not a debate over political issues that you become violent in the tradition of war. It's that's a capability I'm just going to mess with. And I may have to keep doing that, because it's really talking about the United States' position in the world as the leading power, and what is the responsibility of the hegemon to maintain order and not get disruptions.
So you're saying what constitutes a hybrid war then is not the content of it, but rather the context of it.
I think that's fair.
Okay, let's take another question.
Great question.
Back there.
You mentioned that the coming war with China would be in outer space, but you also gave an example of what they're doing in the South China Sea.
Well, he
would, yeah. We're not creating, dry land out of whether it's water.
It'll start in outer space, and then I said it would start in outer space and come down.
But in the concrete situation that we're facing today, you also mentioned that one of the strategic purposes of the United States Navy was to keep sea lanes open and to prevent other powers from restricting or closing those sea lanes. So my question is this: what is the strategy of the United States today, as implemented by the Navy, as China is expanding the South China Sea? What would happen, for example, if all of a sudden they had a 12-mile territorial limit and a 200-mile economic zone around these man-made islands? What can we do?
which is what they're actually starting to do right now. They're starting to press a claim, a legal claim, that that is now territorial water that belongs to them. A territorial claim doesn't carry a lot of weight, but you might remember the old adage that Teddy Roosevelt liked to bring out, you know, speak softly and carry a big stick. The Chinese aren't just building islands and saying, we own that, therefore everything around it is ours also. They've started to emplace anti-air defenses on those islands. It's one of the very first things they were doing. They've started to build air bases on those islands so they can use them as a form of power projection as well. It's not just that they want to claim that territory, it's also bringing their forces closer to any potential targets of their aggression. And so that's part of what makes us nervous there. The United States has made some counterclaims, as have other states, that effectively you don't get to invent islands in the middle of the ocean, that the land is what it is, but you're not allowed to create new territory and call dibs on it. And right now, there's no real authority in the world that can adjudicate that question. And unfortunately, in history, when states have had a fundamental disagreement about what you could or couldn't do, typically it's been force of arms that has decided the issue, and to the victor went the spoils. So could you potentially see a war over this? You absolutely could. And it might be a series of minor events that escalate into something greater as each state refuses to back down in a rising conflict. When you consider how much of the world's trade goes through that territory, you can see why the Chinese would want to lay claim to it and would want to control and or be able to shut down that territory at will.
In 2010, the United States did the Pacific Pivot. You probably heard about it in the Defense Department documents and things like that. But we've been a little busy in other parts of the world. And so through diplomatic channels and through economic channels, we've been trying to get the Chinese to not be too belligerent, although I don't know if it's our call to make. The Chinese have been slowly testing the international diplomatic waters, literally, to try to see what they can get away with. And Everett brought it up very well when he said they have a different way of thinking about diplomacy and expansion and empire, small e empire, than we do. And the United States is still struggling with how the Chinese are doing things, and we're trying to figure out what their ultimate objectives are.
Well, and this is clearly, in my view, a violation of international law. In that area of the South China Sea, the exclusive economic zones have been long mapped out, and there should be an international response. The United States, however, as the hegemon, tends to be the one that protects. But to what extent do we want to initiate a conflict over this, et cetera? And to what extent do we want China to become a more responsible and even partner sharing as the United States' relative power declines into being a responsible, at least regional hegemon? And maybe this is part of what they're doing. But territorial water, as was pointed out, you know, it used to be 3 miles, then 6 miles, then 12 miles, because that was the distance a cannon could take. It was the distance you could defend your claim. And in West Texas, of course, water rights were based on, are you willing to defend your water rights that you claim? And so that's why the emplacements are going in, et cetera. It's a tough case, but it's like and I hate that international relations has so many food metaphors, but it's salami tactics. It's the mouse that comes out and takes a little bite of the salami, and it's not that big, but after a while the whole salami's gone. There's marble cakes
now I'm hungry.
All right, you fellow with the pink.
Oh, sure. This is more curious because I think it, at least in my mind, provides a great background. And this will happen to you, a medievalist in the room. How much has the feudal revolution entered into these discussions about hybrid warfare?
In what way?
Well, I mean, the Chinese example is pretty much straight encastellation. They have a zone, they have resources there, and now they're building castles to control the territory and then make use of the resources. You could make an argument in the case of both cyber and space war that these are new areas that are unclaimed, and what we currently are seeing is somewhat of a fuel revolution where various actors, like a knight in the Dark Ages, would go out and build his castle, and now he controls this valley or this pass or this ford, and you either have to kick him out of it, or you work him into the system in such a way that he does homage to the guy above him.
Sure, I think cyber is a bit more difficult to make the claim because cyber is not necessarily individual pathways.
Yeah.
It's redundancy and multiple speed of light connections that is different. Leaving that one aside, it is, you could make that analogy, it would be a little bit strained, but it is the Chinese, what the Chinese seem to be doing is laying claims to territories that they think are theirs at the expense of others, using power projection and using their military and economic might to push their way around. And like I said just a second ago, and so I'll stop with this, is they're trying to see kind of what they can get away with before it becomes an international issue, because it is not yet. But if they start shooting down airplanes or sinking ships, then it will be. But they're combining, and this is where it becomes the hybrid concept in the gray zone, literally on the map, but also in the cyber domain. They're using cyber very effectively to take everybody's attention away from what they're doing in the South China Sea. And they're being very effective with it.
Well, and they've got long, long, long standing claims to that historically, and they haven't been able to defend it for the last several hundred years, and now they're sort of reclaiming that traditional right in their view, which we can sort of look at as reasonable. And the problem is it looks like appeasement when we let them go in there. And now appeasement didn't have a bad name until 1938 in Munich, and now it's not always bad. If there's a legitimate gripe, and that by accepting the position and saying, okay, that's enough, and that will actually satisfy it, and you can think of, say, the Palestinian-Israeli relations where that might go, or in the Ukraine and the Crimea. If this is a legitimate, you can say, okay, that's reasonable. The people in that area are heavily nationalist Chinese or something, and it is a historical thing, and this is the end of it, then it might be best just to let them have it. If, however, it's just a stepping off point to further expansion, you know, and then it's the Sudeten land, and then it's Putin, and then, you know, who knows what's going on, then it's a bad idea. It puts you in a worse situation. So what we have to do is what is the context? Is it castellation? Is it a legitimate point for appeasement, or is appeasement here absolutely the wrong? These are the issues, good thing I'm in the ivory tower and don't actually have to make that decision. That's a tough one.
Okay.
I had a question. This is kind of shifting the focus a little bit, but with all of the concept of space war and of cyber warfare and the new robots and all of that stuff and like Earth, what is the role of society and with the military? Because in World War II, you know, we talk about like America wouldn't have been as successful if it weren't for the home front and the position of civilians and society supporting that warfare. And now we have discussions of the lack of support on warfare and what that is doing to the military and the relationship of the military to society. And so where are the people in these new frontiers, I guess?
Well, I would say start with, if you want to go to war, does it require society's consent? Traditionally, if you want to declare war, at least in theory, because it's the legislative branch that does that, and in theory, they're the people's representatives within the government, society had to consent to a war. But as Dr. Goldman noted, we haven't declared war in 70 years. And part of the reason we haven't declared war is when you start to look at what the president can do under a declaration of war, there's very few limits on presidential power in a declared state of war. We've never declared war at a time where we possess nuclear weapons. But now that we do, the destructive capacity that you effectively hand to one human being, and bear in mind, wars end, according to the U.S. Constitution, when the president negotiates a treaty and it is then ratified by the legislative branch. But what if a president refuses to negotiate? What if a president wants to maintain a perpetual state of war because they effectively, for lack of a better term, become a dictator? Again, very few limits on what a president can do during a declared war. So what we see is that American society hasn't always consented to the wars that the United States has engaged in over the last 70 years. Here you have the Vietnam archives, which are a great demonstration of society
not being in favor of a war, but the war continuing, because society didn't really have a mechanism, at least in the short term, to stop that war from continuing. So this role of society, now imagine that you have created devices, unmanned platforms, that allow you to, at least in your own mind, wage war with impunity. I have weapons that you can't counter and that you can't turn back on me. So I can fire my drones, I can have them flying over the battlefields of Iraq and Syria and raining down hellfire missiles because I know the Islamic State can't do anything about it. I can wage war with impunity, and there's nothing they can do to retaliate. Except, no civilization accepts being victimized by war and just takes the punishment. What the Islamic State does instead is it says, all right, we can't actually shoot down your drones, and we can't fire drones back at you. But we can still make you very unhappy. We can inspire terror attacks at an Orlando nightclub, or a San Bernardino community meeting, or any other form of terror attack against civilians. We can attack U.S. embassies around the world. We can find ways to inflict punishment and pain back on you to demonstrate that you can't really wage war with impunity. Unfortunately, political leaders don't always understand all of the ramifications of engaging in conflict. And if you give them a tool that allows them to think they can go to war with no consequences, human nature would suggest they're going to be very tempted to do so.
I'm a big fan of the democratic or Kantian peace. It's simply more difficult for a democratic state to gin up publicly the will of the people to go to war, or even sustain conflicts against the will of the people. And so they don't go to war with other democratic states, but they do have to worry about authoritarian states. So there's a social movement. I'm not going to go too far into that. But exactly as was seen here, and so one of the things that the United States has done to get the social opinion of the war out of it is the all-volunteer force. Unlike Vietnam, which was supported by the American public for a long time, but when the American public finally had enough of the boxes coming home of people who did not sign up for it, who were drafted, that's when the war fell apart. And so we moved to an all-volunteer force. Every one of you is a hero. You're paid fairly well. If you die in support of the rest of us, you get 10% off at Red Lobster, your family or whatever. It's a way of insulating the government from those. And you'll see in European countries that all used to have national service and draft, most of them are going away from that to where it is there. They're also moving into voluntary services instead of having everybody sort of in the draft. Israel still has it, I believe, because of their very precarious position geopolitically. But one of the things that you do is you try to keep, as Thomas Hobbes would say, keep the public out of those issues, keep them politically lumpen or inert. And so I think some of what's happening is that attempt right there to insulate from this long, long conflict the political and social will. And so I'm also a fan of the draft. Not because it makes the military better. This volunteer professional military is very, very, very good at what it does. And a draft would dilute that. It's for social and political reasons that I'm in favor of the draft, not for military reasons.
Okay, last question.
There's a guy in the blue jacket that's been trying very hard. Yes, there he is, right there, yes.
Gentlemen, Gary, how do you all envision the World South of our force, World Military Committee, changing in response to hybrid warfare, countries aside, and the countries aside?
Well, let me take that one.
By all means.
The United States, Paul and I are writing a book right now. The United States traditionally relies heavily on technology. And I think we see that even to this day. JSF 35, the new Virginia class submarine, the new aircraft carriers built in Newport Beach, Virginia, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Cyber is going to be a high-tech field with very low entry costs at the front end simply because it's off-the-shelf stuff. I'm not convinced that the size of the force will change much. I think what you're going to see is a change in the composition, in that you're going to get new areas of emphasis by the services, especially the Air Force, because we're the high-tech. The Air Force is the high-tech. We're the high-tech people. We have space. We have cyber. We have
PGMs, we got drones, we got all the cool stuff, we got all the great toys. You're going to see a different group of people come into the service who are much more technologically oriented. Okay, I can barely work my iPhone. I have it in my pocket. It's ringers off though, because I'm good. Everett can't work his at all. But you guys are all going to be so embedded with the technology and the future technology that's coming up that you'll understand it, you'll know how to use it and work it for military success. And what you'll see is, I'm not sure the numbers will change much, but I think the composition will change to a much more technologically savvy force that's able to harness unmanned aerial vehicles and cyber power and space power and unmanned space power for better strategic effect in the wars that we fight. And so it's less about the numbers and more about the people who will be in the service, I think.
Yeah, by the way, on the phone thing, I just had my 30th anniversary and people started calling me. My phone was blowing up. It's a Galaxy 7. I'm going to disagree with my colleague a little bit in that I don't think cyber is a man-made domain. In fact, if we're going to go down that road, then every domain is man-made. What we've done now with computers is we have access to it. Nobody thought the air was a war domain until we had airplanes. And even then, a lot of people thought you could go to the moon, you know, and still breathe all the way there. Space does not become a domain until we start imagining putting satellites there. What we're doing right now with Stuxnet and other types of things is sort of what you might do with a missile from one land point to another. We're going through the cyber domain, the internet, to have effects somewhere else. When we start thinking about fighting wars in that virtual area, by the way, if all computers went away, we'd still have the cyber domain, we just wouldn't be able to access it. That's sort of where I'm going on that. So we're going to have a whole generation of people who thinks about a virtual war in a different way than we do. Just as you think about a space war in a different, as gravity and delta V, and not in kinetic effects necessarily, or movement across distances, physical distance, but movement in terms of how much it costs you to move from one position to another. Air warfare and marshaling planes at a specific time with enough fuel left to be able to actually conduct a mission in mass. Different ways of thinking about war. And the people who are going to do that are the people who grow up with this internet technology. Space has not captured the imagination in the way the internet has, because every one of you, I bet, has access to the internet right now in this room, either on phones or laptops or something you have with you. I quite often leave mine at home, but I'm still back in the old century. If something, you know, when my daughter wakes up in the morning, she grabs her phone. That's the first thing she does and she checks in. And if she doesn't have her phone, she gets really nervous. I mean, there's a different way of thinking about this interaction in a virtual world that we all have. Now, how do we compete? What's the equivalent of boots on the ground in a virtual world? And to what difference does that make? That's not going to be guys like us who are going to come up with that part of it, though we're going to try to promote that. That'll be another generation. And I do believe the nature of conflict and political warfare conflict will stay with the same basic principles. But the context is going to change dramatically. And we'll make the same mistakes in a new environment. We'll learn from it.
Hard to believe he owns a rotary dial cell phone, isn't it?
Yeah. I remember when I was at U.S. Space Command in 1989, when Motorola was pitching the Iridium constellation, and they had this phone in a bag, and my good friend Pavlik got me one for one of my birthdays or something, this thing like this, and they said, imagine this, the world is going to change, because you won't call someone's house to see if they're home, you won't call their business to talk to them, you will call them. And we all went, But it changed everything. I mean, you have your phone with you all the time. It's just a different way of thinking, and the possibilities have just been amazing. And we need to protect that. And that's going to be the job of you guys in funny t-shirts.
Okay, thanks guys, it's been great.
Thank you.